the chupacabra. After my husband died, it was as if I was a magnet and my bed was a refrigerator. Getting out of bed was as difficult as bowling while wearing ice skates. My friend brought me guavas. My sister brought me quesitos. My aunt brought me tostones rellenos. But the thought of eating made me as nauseous as someone with food poisoning. The food sat in my house as if I feared that it was poisoned by a vengeful lover. One night, I heard pots and pans banging, but was too enmeshed in despondency to go investigate the clamorous racket. Pablo, my husband's favorite goat, wandered in my bedroom and sat his head on the bed like a dog. I stroked Pablo's head. He climbed into bed and nestled beside me before closing his tiny eyes. The next day, I was up and cleaning the house. Performing any task was still like trying to force a broken arm to do a series of complex yoga poses. But at least I was able to get things done. Pablo followed me everywhere. "That goat has saved you," said my abuelita. How Pablo got into the house is a question that time would never discern. Over time, I was able to do more and more tasks. Like someone who has suffered a stroke and been forced to relearn how to walk and talk. I wasn't all right, but at least I was close enough to all right to be like a cat with three legs. Then, one night, my semblance of tranquility was shattered like a vase tossed from the roof of a skyscraper. I was awakened by the shrieks of goats, which echoed through the house like the sound effects of a haunted mansion ride. I grabbed my flashlight and walked towards the goat pasture. Pablo walked by my side. He ambled forward at a hesitant pace, as if he was a cat walking towards a room full of barking dogs. When we reached the pasture, I noticed that a number of goats were dead. They were lying on the ground asleep, but there were three holes in their chests. Strangely, no blood poured from any of the holes. It was as if each hole was a natural part of the goat's anatomy. I heard a loud slurping sound, as if someone was sucking the straw of a milkshake that would not easily be sucked up. My muscles tensed. My heart rate increased. Sweat poured down from my body. I felt myself shaking as if I were wearing a t-shirt in a snowstorm. Suddenly, I saw that the creature had its long fangs in the chest of one of the dead goats. The creature was leathery, as if its skin was made from the fabric of an uncomfortable couch. Long spines protruded from the creature's back, like the appendages of a dinosaur. I realized I was gazing upon the chupacabra from urban legend. Thus, just then, the chupacabra lunged onto Pablo like a lion or cheetah. Pablo let out a shriek as if he was a squealing pig. I rushed towards the creature and whacked it with my flashlight. The chupacabra made a sound that was a combination of an eagle's cry and a tiger's roar. Then, and scooped him into my arms as if I was Mary in Michelangelo's Pietà. Three holes were in Pablo's chest, but they were bloody rather than bare of blood. I carried Pablo into the house and phoned the vet, Juan. Juan arrived an hour later, accommodating the late hour because he had been a friend of my late husband's. It must have been a feral dog attack, Juan said, groggy like a cat that has been awakened from a long nap. I'll have to operate right away. It was no dog, I said. Pablo survived the operation, but he had an uncanny aura took a pasture with him. The other goats gave him a certain death wounds. They would move away so he could walk through. When certain people touched poplar, they would have visions of events that occurred in the past or would occur in the future. Now that you've saved Pablo, my Aguinita says, it looks as if you will save many others.